I always loved, my whole life I've loved great songwriters. And songs are transcendent. Some people say that music is sort of the common language of the world, you know? But you know, when you travel throughout the world, you start to realize that you know, Heschel actually says this. Abraham Joshua Heschel was one that said that it's not so much music as it is prayer. There's something that we find in the Psalms that we don't really find anywhere else. There's something that we find in poetry that often we don't find anywhere else. There's an element of telling the truth, of longing for the truth, and so songs have a way of transcending. You know, they get into your emotions, your experience, and similar maybe to a parable, they often have embedded within them principle and experience. And they're kind of flowing together. But prayer and melody transcend language barriers. Passion also does, but when I'm up against a language barrier, I can hit on a melody. Much like Johnny was saying yesterday, melody, he was talking about, it only takes a melody. It almost seems simple, but when I'm up against a language barrier, poetry doesn't transcend the language barrier. In fact, sometimes poetry, it's hard to really translate to a different language great poetry. But melody translates. And so I can be in anywhere in the world and I can, or story translates. And it transcends culture, language, and so music has a way of somehow getting behind our borders, right? And we begin to experience something, and in experiencing that, we learn something new. Pretty much, if you were to structure the Psalms, the reason that they're prophetic to me is because you're constantly in this cycle when you read through the Psalms that we're actually in our own daily life and experience. And that cycle is, you know, Brueggemann says it this way, that it's we're oriented, and then we're disoriented, and then we're reoriented. Or there's this first stage of naivety, and then there's this disorientation from what we thought things were, and then there's this second stage of naivety, as I like it even better, because that kind of idea makes us realize that this is going to be ongoing, and that when we get to that reorientation, it doesn't mean that we're not going to be reoriented again. A great example of that is, you know, like Plato in his cave after Socrates dies. He talks to this cave and he talks about shadows on the wall and the campfires, right? And Plato, after Socrates dies, he says, if somebody actually had the courage, if a just man, 300 years before Jesus, he says, if a just man actually came into the cave and drew us away from our, you know, campfire, right? And our shadows on the wall, we'd bind him, we'd beat him, and we'd kill him, right? And so, in essence, there's an element to our worship that has to be prophetic, because if it wasn't prophetic, then it's simply fiction. And it's not prophetic in the sense that we're trying to say things about people's future or fortune or things like that. But prophetic in this sense that, like our questions, it has the courage to come and drag us from our fiction and drag us to the light of the sun, to turn and face the sun, but we love to, even within Christianity, we love to worship shadows of ourself and ideas that we have of who Jesus really is, and because of that, we're terrified of questions, because questions represent like buckets of water, and those little buckets of water are going to put out our little campfire. But if somebody has the courage to draw us out of that, which sometimes that's what happens with music, people that can, you know, we've had musicians like Bob Dylan that he says statements like this, you know, that every child is born with the truth. They just get it beat out of them by the time they can walk. I mean, ideas like that are, there are people that have the courage, the same courage that we actually, all of us, even sitting in church, already have. There's already a prophetic sense that the average person in a church has because they're children of God. And there's something in them that knows when somebody starts speaking the truth, there's an ice that starts cracking, right? And we're terrified of those little buckets of water around our little campfires, but it's not just the church, it's atheism, it's secular humanism, it's all the little ideologies that we have within our culture, because you know it's just a little campfire when people are afraid of questions. And we lock into our oikos, but man, when we start following Jesus the Son, we're not afraid of questions, we're not afraid of buckets of water. You could have thousands of people bring buckets of water and just say to them, hey, have at it, man, just throw the buckets of water at the sun and try to put it out, right? I mean, so this sense of when we get, you know, when we control and we try to keep our campfire going, you know, we sort of are preferring to live in a fictitious reality. But worship, if it does anything, if it's of any value, just like religion, Christianity, it's the answer to the ultimate questions. And the ultimate question is always like, there's got to be something more. It's like Plato, the boy in the cave, it's through reason that he finds himself to the edge and he sees the sun. And there's got to be an element of turning and facing the sun in our worship, or we might as well just be singing songs about anything.